Međugorje je malo mjesto u brdima zapadne Hercegovine, nedaleko Mostara, 100 km istočno od Splita i isto toliko sjeverozapadno od Dubrovnika. To je kraj naseljen katoličkim Hrvatima koji, nakon što su Turci 1878. morali napustiti Bosnu i Hercegovinu, nije vraćen Hrvatskoj državi, nego je Bečki dvor cijelo oslobođeno područje kao posebnu administrativnu cjelinu zadržao u svojoj izravnoj vlasti. I prva i druga Jugoslavija, vođena protukatoličkim i uopće protuzapadnjačkim režimima, zadržala je to hrvatsko područje izvan granica Republike Hrvatske. Ovo je brdo na kojem se prema kazivanju djece 24. lipnja 1981. ukazala Gospa. Brdo ukazanja zapravo je kameniti obronak škrta raslinja gdje su se dogodila prva viđenja. Ono je centar dolaska hodočasnika iz cijeloga svijeta. Svi koji dođu u Međugorje popnu se uz ovo brdo. Sačuvalo se kako je i bilo. Jedino hodočasnici ostaviše mnoštvo neobrađenih drvenih raspela, nalik ovom škrtom raslinju. I mnogi odnesoše kao svete uspomene po koji kamen ili šaku crvene zemlje.
Tajnovita nebeska pojava izričito se predstavila kao kraljica mira, pozivajući na opraštanje i pomirenje među svim ljudima, bez obzira na nacionalne, političke, religijske i ideološke razlike. Prvih nekoliko godina policija je nastojala uplašiti i odvratiti hodočasnike, zaustavljajući vozila i vršeći neugodne pretrese.
Zanimljivo. Dok je komunistička vlast klevetala vidioce i tamošnje svećenike, želeći nasiljem odvratiti hodočasnike, mjesni biskup branio je njihovu čast i njihova osobna prava. Čim je državni pritisak popustio, biskup je kao po nepisanom pravilu biskupskog ponašanja u sličnim slučajevima postao sumnjičav, podvrgavajući događaje i vidioce vrlo kritičkim ispitivanjima i ograničenjima.
Mnoštva iz cijeloga svijeta ubrzo su nagrnula u Međugorje. Sve je na prvi mah bilo vrlo prepoznatljivo. U glavnim crtama po poznatim scenarijima iz Lurda godine 1854. i Fatime godine 1917. Sasvim obična seoska djeca, nimalo pobožnija ni sabranija od prosjeka vršnjaka u toj sredini, negdje izvan sela susreću djevicu koja s njima stupa u razgovor da pozove svijet na obraćanje, molitvu i pokoru, da učvrsti vjeru i odbije nasrtaje sotone. Onda se stane okupljati svijet. Opažaju se neobične svjetlosne pojave, događaju se i neobjašnjiva ozdravljenja.
U Lurdu je vidjelica bila jedna. U Fatimi bilo ih je troje. U Međugorju šestero. Za razliku od Lurda i Fatime, u Međugorju se viđenja događaju već 3 desetljeća. Tko piše te scenarije? Crkvena vlast očito ne, jer biskupi se kao po pravilu dugo čak desetljećima protive. Sa svojim komisijama sumnjiče tu djecu da fantaziraju, lažu ili da su duševno bolesna.
Thank you.
When they see the Virgin Mary, the visionaries claim that they are totally disconnected from the environment, that they don't hear other people, that they don't see other people, that they are completely concentrated on the apparition of the Virgin Mary.
Every week, the Virgin is said to appear to the young visionaries at a Friday service. Bellanger set up his camera and sat back to watch.
Now, they made the sign of the cross and they begin the prayer, Our Father. And during that prayer, suddenly there is the beginning of the ecstasy. They kneel down and they are in contact with the Virgin Mary.
If they're truly in ecstasy, nothing should distract the children. But suddenly, to Bellanger's later amazement, an onlooker called Jean-Louis jabbed his hand towards Witzka on the right.
At the moment of filming, I did not see that. Just afterwards, I saw there was a commotion in the chapel. Everybody was disturbed because Witzka had reacted. Jean-Louis made a threat gesture against the eyes of Witzka, towards the eyes of Witzka, and she reacted. And it was for Jean-Louis an important disappointment.
Still frames from Bellanger's video at the moment of the hand lunging at Witzka show her clearly recoiling from the jabbing fingers.
Then the fingers of Jean-Louis are going back. Still no reaction from Witzka. A slight reaction, closing of her eyes. And then on the next picture, you have the spectacular movement of the face of Witzka. She is reacting, going back. After the ecstasy, I had forgotten to stop the camera, and suddenly Witzka comes in with somebody else.
She wanted to explain why she'd moved. In her trance, she'd been trying to prevent the Virgin from dropping the infant Jesus.
So she said, when I arrived in the chapel, and everything was okay, when the ecstasy began, I saw nobody, and I heard nobody, except the Virgin Mary. And the Virgin Mary had the infant Jesus in her arms. And suddenly, I thought, said Witzka, that the infant Jesus would fall on the floor. So to impeach that, I made a gesture to impeach the infant Jesus to fall on the floor. And she thought that it would explain the reaction that she had against the threat gesture made by Jean-Louis.
But as I said earlier, and you know, by their fruits, what are the fruits? The first fruit is it has to teach the truth.
Yeah, well,
and if it doesn't teach the truth, it's a false apparition.
And if it's teaching you that it doesn't matter what religion you belong to, and you believe that, you're going to go to hell. So it doesn't. Is Vigilier something you should follow? No. If you, I mean, there's a father, a priest from northern Italy, from Russia, who said the devil was appearing. It's a vision of the devil.
And yeah, there's stories of that, yes.
Well,
yes.
In fact, he's got a whole report, a whole magazine, as Father Luigi Villa, mm-hmm. who's been commissioned by Pope Pius XII and Padre Pio to fight masonry within the church. Anyway, his magazine says that, but the fact is, I mean, it's reported by, again, I believe Pope Medjugorje books, that the devil did appear one time at Medjugorje. I mean, appeared as the devil.
Mm-hmm.
And then when the children saw it, he transformed himself into Our Lady before their eyes.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
the stories of what has really happened at Medjugorje is not really told. And mm-hmm. when you have the seers, now our friend Jim Demers, he was at this event. They had this huge stadium full of people. And the main attraction was you come out and you watch the Medjugorje seer have an apparition, and you pay your money and Jim saw this, and he said it was one of the most horrifying things he ever saw. Because it was either demonic or just very bold charlatanism, you know, not exactly Catholic.
Charlatanism, meaning they were putting on a show for pay. And
yeah.
I am.
Black spot, or what some have called the black hole sun issue, which meant that the camera, when reacting to extremely bright point light sources, like of course the sun, would create a hideous black spot in the center of it.
Opširnije o sportskom bloku dnevnika svakako, a Međugorje već treći dan zaredom pohodi veliki broj hodočasnika. Prije dvije večeri u kući Vidjelice Vitske, prema riječima svjedoka, zasvijetilo je Gospin kip, star 40 godina. Pjesa se brzo proširila i od tada u ovu kuću stalno dolaze vjernici. Svjetlost niko nije uspio objasniti, a tokom jučerašnjeg dana svjetlost na Gospinom kipu nije bila vidljiva, ali naveče jeste.
Nema tu čuda, sve jeftin trik, kažu naučnici komentarišući novo čudo iz Međugorja. Dr. Pavle Močilac, hemičar Instituta za organsku hemiju i biohemiju u Pragu, kaže da je neko očigledno u želji da napravi predstavu prebojio Gospin kip premazom na bazi stroncium aluminata. To je izazvalo prirodni efekat fosforescencije, odnosno isijavanja svjetlosti u mraku. Drugi naučnici smatraju da bi trebalo otići u Međugorje i na licu mjesta ispitati šta je to izazvalo neobičnu svjetlost. Vatikan nikada nije potvrdio vjerodostojnost Međugorja kao mjesta prikazanja Djevice Marije prije 30 godina. Svoj konačan sud trebalo bi da daju do kraja godine. Hiljade katoličkih vjernika zato nemaju sumnje. Oni u kolonama stoje ispred kuće Vitske Ivanković-Mijatović da na trenutak vide Gospu. Vjerski turizam u Međugorju cvjeta, a prodavci suvenira zadovoljno trljaju ruke. Toliko o vjeri. Ako želi dašak Međugorje u svom domu, to može da riješi putem interneta. Na stranici za kupoprodaju eBay za $250 možete kupiti kip Gospe identičan onom u Vitskinoj kući. Kip je visok 63,5 cm i težak 3,5 kg, te svijetli u mraku. Kako navodi prodavač, statua je u dobrom stanju, osim na pojedinim mjestima na kojima nedostaje boja. Za kupovinu Gospe od eBay-a ostalo je još 15 dana kada se završava aukcija.
In addition to supernatural signs, numerous bona fide healings have been recorded. David Parks was healed of terminal cancer while on pilgrimage to Medjugorje.
Well, I went out to Medjugorje spiritually bankrupt. I went out with just a few weeks to live. I had a serious illness for 12 years and had 10 major surgeries. And after the last surgery, I was told I had weeks to live. I went out and that's where I found our Blessed Mother. That's where I found she came. I received a great physical healing, but most important of all, a spiritual healing. And my whole life has been transformed because of the messages of Our Lady, because she all he asks to do is pray, pray and pray.
Some of the apparition's messages are shamelessly unbiblical.
I am she who is related to the divine Trinity. I am the Virgin of Revelation.
Yet God declares, I am the first and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God.
My children, I am the door of heaven and the help on earth.
In the Sermon on the Mount, the Lord referred to the broad road which would lead to destruction, and many there be that find that road. But then he talked about the narrow road, namely himself, and few there would be who would find him. So it is the narrow road. There is only one path to God. Jesus said, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved. There is only one way to heaven, and that is through Christ and him crucified.
There are many other problems. For instance, the apparition even commands her followers to venerate her statues.
As mother, I want to tell you that I am here with you, represented by the statue you have here. Each of my statues is a sign of a presence of mine and reminds you of your heavenly mother. Therefore, it must be honored and put in places of greater veneration. You should look with love at every image of your heavenly mother.
Contrast this with the Lord's command given in Deuteronomy. Take careful heed to yourselves, for you saw no form when the Lord spoke to you at Horeb out of the midst of the fire, lest you act corruptly and make for yourselves a carved image in the form of any figure, the likeness of male or female. The apparition has also requested shrines be erected in her honor around the globe.
I ardently desire a temple built for me here, where I can show and offer all my love, compassion, help, and protection. For I am your merciful mother.
Most of the apparitions ask for a shrine to be built, and shrines are built. There are thousands all over the world. And people come and kneel before Mary. I've seen them walking on their knees, bloody knees, at Fatima and so forth. And they're doing this out of penance and trying to curry Mary's favor. You don't have to do that. Furthermore, we don't need Mary's favor. We need Christ's redemption, his grace and mercy, and it comes to us by grace. It's not of works. Otherwise, it wouldn't be grace. So you can't earn it. And never, ever did anyone in the Bible bow down before Mary, even when Mary was there at the birth of Jesus. It says they worshipped him. They didn't bow down to Mary or to Joseph.
When these apparitions are pointing to Mary and asking the people to give her great reverence and to honor her with shrines or with these other things, it flies in the face of the scripture of which Jesus said the Holy Spirit will lead us to the worship of Jesus and him alone.
It is very apparent to me that the Mary of the Bible is not the Mary of the apparitions that are taking place in the world today. Because the apparition Mary draws attention to herself, and the Mary of the Bible clearly pointed people to Jesus Christ, her son.
If the apparitions are not Mary, who then is appearing? Ironically, the apparition gives us the answer.
I am Mary, the Queen of Heaven and the Queen of Angels.
Mary is definitely the Queen of Heaven. She's a mother of God. She's our mother. There's no other woman in this whole world that ever could compare to the Blessed Mother.
The apparitions often come in the name or the term the Queen of Heaven. And this is interesting to me in light of the scriptures, because in the Old Testament, Jeremiah talked about very clearly the Queen of Heaven as an abomination before God.
Repeatedly in the book of Jeremiah, God himself identifies the Queen of Heaven as a pagan goddess and rebukes his people for following her. My people Israel make cakes for the Queen of Heaven, and they pour out drink offerings to other gods, that they may provoke me to anger. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, behold, my anger and my fury will be poured out on this place. Despite the apparition's claims, God is jealous for his glory. I am the Lord, that is my name, and my glory I will not give to another, nor my praise to carved images.
Many apparitions give the message that Mary is the mediator or intercessor for mankind. That is contrary to the scriptures. In the book of Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25, the Bible says that Jesus Christ ever lives to make intercession for the saints. And in the book of 1 Timothy and in the book of Hebrews, the Bible declares that there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. For someone to be the mediator between God and man, he had to be fully God, he had to be fully man, he had to be sinless, and Jesus Christ, indeed, is fully God and fully man.
Little children, I am the mother of good counsel, mediator, who is trying to persuade you to listen to the call. My message is of faith, love, and hope. More than anything, it brings reconciliation between people and nations. It is the only thing that can save this century from war and eternal death.
Jesus is the only way, the only truth, and the only life, and he is the bridge builder between God and men. And if you try to go to the right or the left, you'll never get there. It's only through Jesus Christ, period.
The Bible states clearly, there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. Not only does the apparition claim to be our mediator and intercessor, but she also claims to be our advocate with God.
The world is degenerating, so much so that it was necessary for the Father and the Son to send me into the world, among all the peoples, in order to be their advocate and to save them.
We are told in 1 John 2 that if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. Christ alone was righteous, and therefore he, on the basis of his righteousness, is able to intercede, to advocate for sinners. And so these roles belong exclusively to Christ and cannot in any shape or form be ascribed to Mary.
Jesus Christ is our advocate. He never suggested that anybody come to him through Mary, never on this earth. And not now. Never ever is this stated. And furthermore, it denigrates Jesus Christ. Why can't I go right to him? He's my Savior. He's the one who loves me. And he said that we would go to the Father through him. Then where does Mary come in? Not in the Bible.
In addition to these claims, the apparition actually says she is here to save the world.
I call upon you to open yourselves completely to me, so that through each of you, I may be enabled to convert and save the world. I alone am able still to save you from the calamities which approach. Those who place their confidence in me will be saved. My daughter, in this time I am the ark for all your brethren. I am the ark of peace. I am the ark of salvation. The ark where my children must enter if they wish to live in the kingdom of God.
The Apostle Peter proclaimed that Jesus has become the chief cornerstone, nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. And throughout the Bible, God proclaims, you shall know no God but me, for there is no Savior besides me. Furthermore, the apparition ascribes to herself many additional characteristics that only God possesses. For example, she claims to be ever-present.
You will never be alone. My Immaculate Heart will be your refuge and the way which will lead you to God. At every moment, you must be just as I would have you be. At every moment, you must do just what I would have you to do. Do not be afraid. I will always be near you. Do not be grieved. I am with all of you, even though you do not see me. I am mother of all of you sinners.
An amazing thing about the apparitions, she is claiming to be at the same place at the same time all over the world. That is claiming to have attributes of deity. Only God has the attribute of omniscience, omnipresence, and omnipotence.
They are ascribing godlike qualities to Mary, who was a humble handmaid of the Lord, obedient to the Lord. She is a wonderful example to believers, but she is certainly not the omnipresent, omniscient, omnipotent Mary of Roman Catholicism.
Of course, Jesus, who is God Almighty, promised his followers, "I am with you always, even to the end of the age." The apparition has even proclaimed herself co-redemptrix.
I stand here as the co-redemptrix and advocate. Everything should be concentrated on that. Repeat this after me. The new dogma will be the dogma of the co-redemptrix. Until I am acknowledged there where the Most Holy Trinity has willed me to be, I will not be able to exercise my power fully in the maternal work of co-redemption and of the universal mediation of graces.
The whole idea that Mary is to be a co-redemptrix of Jesus Christ, of course, is contrary to biblical understanding. It's one thing to be a little heterodox, it's one thing to be at the periphery, it's quite another to go in direct opposition to the central truth of the Bible. We're not talking about details. Many denominations have exaggerations or views about some of the what we'll call peripheral issues. We're talking here about going head-to-head to the central theme of the gospel. And when I say gospel, I mean that theme that God has laid out from Genesis chapter 3 to the end. And that's why these assertions, these claims, are anti-biblical, not just non-biblical, anti-biblical, and are dangerous.
We read in Revelation concerning Jesus, "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood." And throughout the Bible, God reiterates that He alone is the Redeemer. "As for our Redeemer, the Lord of hosts is His name, the Holy One of Israel." In addition to these anti-biblical assertions, the apparition of Mary claims to suffer and even atone for sins.
I love you even when you are far away from me and my son. I ask you not to allow my heart to shed tears of blood because of the souls who are being lost through sin. For a long time I have suffered for you. If I do not want my son to abandon you, I am forced to pray to him myself without ceasing. You pay no heed. However much you would do, you could never recompense the pain I have taken for you. I boldly assert that his suffering became my suffering because his heart was mine. And just as Adam and Eve sold the world for an apple, so in a certain sense, my son and I redeemed the world with one heart.
Many of the apparitions that people are getting today of Mary, she claims to suffer and atone with Jesus. That is not biblical, because the Bible declares that Christ suffered for our sins. In fact, when he died, he said, "It is finished." He has paid our sins and our suffering completely on the cross.
Peter writes, "For Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit." And the book of Hebrews states that Jesus, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God, from that time waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. For by one offering, he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. There is no longer an offering for sin.
I've often heard Roman Catholic people and prelates teaching that Mary was suffering for sin. But by saying that, they fail to understand what it means to suffer for sin. To suffer for sin is to suffer vicariously as a substitute. And it means to take punishment inflicted upon you by God. And the Word of God makes it plain, for instance, in Isaiah 53, that he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities, and the chastisement of our peace was laid upon him. This is referring prophetically to Christ. The last verse of Romans 4 says that he, Christ, was delivered for our offenses. Peter says that he, that is Christ, bore our sins in his own body upon the tree. And the suffering for sin had to involve death, because the wages of sin is death. So therefore, Mary in no sense suffered for us.
This comparison could go on and on, as the apparition ascribes to Mary nearly every attribute found only in Christ.
We have examined only church-approved messages and those from Medjugorje, yet even these clearly contradict the Bible. Certainly the humble maidservant of the Lord would never draw attention to herself, nor would the Blessed Virgin Mary ever contradict the Word of God. If this is not the Mary of Nazareth, then how do we explain these events? Who or what is behind these manifestations?
The Scriptures warn us very clearly that Satan is a master deceiver, and that Satan actually can appear as an angel of light. And we know that the Word of God is light. So Satan can actually manifest himself in the form of the truth, or appear to be true, and yet be deceptive. Satan, we're told, is like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Or as Paul writes, he is the one who schemes or plans to deceive the whole world. He's the god of this world, who blinds the minds of the unbelieving so that they might not see the light of the glorious gospel. He has a master plan to deceive.
I believe that we must test every experience by the Word of God. I think that is clear in the case of Peter, who had a marvelous experience, the transfiguration of Christ. And yet, in his own epistle, he wrote, "We have a more sure word of prophecy," and he was referring to the Word of God. That is the standard by which we must judge all things, not our own personal experience, because experiences are most unreliable.
The Bible warns of a false peace and unity that will deceive the nations. Furthermore, Jesus and the New Testament writers caution that deception will increase in the last days. For example, Paul writes, "But evil men and impostors will grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived." In addition, the Bible warns that the coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan, with all power, signs, and lying wonders, and with all unrighteous deception among those who perish, because they did not receive the love of the truth, that they might be saved.
Throughout the New Testament, we see many different writers, and of course Jesus himself, warning regarding deception in the last days. Jesus said, "Many will be deceived in my name by many." Paul talked about this deception regarding an apostasy that would take place, and many being deceived, believing the lie. Peter writes about the deception. Beware of deception that's coming. And believe me, it seems to be happening all around us.
In Matthew 24:24, it says this. This is again Jesus speaking in 24. He says, "For false Christ and false prophets will arise and show great signs and wonders, as to be deceived, if possible, the very elect." So Jesus here in the 24th chapter, he's speaking to his disciples, he's speaking to us too, and he's sharing that in the last days there's going to be a great deception. There's going to be not only Mary worshipers, but there's going to be also other worshipers that will come in the name of Christ saying they have the right way.
Jesus predicts that prior to his return, that false prophets would arise and if possible would even deceive the elect. That suggests to me that these signs and wonders would be so convincing that apart from the grace of God, even genuine Christians can find themselves being deceived and led away. And only by trusting in Jesus and Him totally will we find liberty and freedom from sin. And I would call upon you, if you're out there and you're trusting in your church, you're trusting in your works, none of that will save you. What you need is to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, that He will set you free and He will give you eternal life today.
Whenever a person says that they are trusting in Jesus and, the moment they say and, they've gone too far. Our trust in Jesus alone will bring to us salvation and eternal life. There is a hymn that is sung in the church that talks about, "I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand."
The Bible is very clear regarding the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that is the message which sets us free. That Jesus Christ loved us so much that He Himself came to this earth and died for us as a sacrifice for our sins. We couldn't do it. He did. And because of His sacrifice, and because of who He is and what He's done, and when we recognize who we are and what we've done, and ask Him to forgive us for our sins, the Bible says that we can enter into a relationship with Him, the Creator of the universe, and that relationship will last for eternity. Jesus is the Creator, He is the Redeemer. There is only one Redeemer, and His name is Jesus Christ.
You must choose whether to follow Jesus and Him alone, or to risk following a deceptive spirit. Jesus loves you and offers eternal life freely for those who will turn to Him by faith. However, the Lord will not force you to follow Him. The choice is yours. Our prayer is that you will test these events with the Word of God and trust in the Jesus of the Bible. His way is the truth and the only road to everlasting life. My name is Patrick Powell, and may the Lord guide you and bless you with His grace and truth.